Here I've got the main results from the Abelluck and Gruber paper. Remember our context. We've got senior citizens choosing among different health insurance plans, and we want to recover their preferences for different characteristics of those plans. Well, here I've got a list of those characteristics. For example, the premium. How much are you going to pay each year for to be covered, just to be covered by this plan? The out-of-pocket costs. How much do you expect to pay out-of-pocket each year for the plan, like when you go to the doctor and you have to pay a copay? Now, for simplicity, I'm going to assume that each person knows exactly how much they have to pay out of pocket. Now, that's not true in real life because you don't know whether you're going to get sick or not. Okay, but to make the points they want to make in the paper, we can just assume that. This third variable is what the authors use to help relax that assumption, so we'll just skip it. These other variables are other financial characteristics of the plan, like what the deductible is and whether it covers the donut hole, etc. So now we've got a whole bunch of numbers in this table. What do they mean? Well, this is kind of like a regression, but not quite. So we can't interpret these numbers as we would in a regression table, but there are a few things we can learn. The first thing is whether this number here is zero or not. If it's not zero, that tells us that people have a preference for this characteristic, in this case, the premium. Okay, and since it's negative here, that means people don't like premiums. That makes sense. Why would you like paying more for a health insurance plan? So that's what this number here means, minus 0.43. We can't interpret its magnitude, but we can see that since it's not zero and it's negative, people don't like premiums. Now, we can also compare relative magnitudes. So here, we've got minus 0.43, and here we've got minus 0.21. So this is about twice as large as this. That means people dislike premiums about twice as much as they dislike out-of-pocket costs. So that's the second thing we can learn from this table. Okay, well, what are their results? Well, the first result is what I just showed. It seems that people dislike premiums twice as much as out-of-pocket costs. And if you go to the other columns, which are just different robustness checks, we see that that relationship is still true. People really, really don't like premiums, okay? They really don't like premiums, especially compared to out-of-pocket costs. Well, why is that weird? Well, remember, here I'm assuming that people know what their expected out-of-pocket costs are. So the total cost of any insurance plan is just my premium plus my out-of-pocket costs. So assuming this, I've got a whole bunch of plans that all cover the same thing, all I should care about is the lowest cost. I should just pick the cheapest plan. But that's not what people are doing. They're not just adding up their total cost and picking the lowest plan, because if they were, we would see that they would have the same preference for premium as out-of-pocket costs, because a dollar is a dollar. Why would I care how I'm spending that dollar, through a higher premium or through higher out-of-pocket costs? We should see that these numbers are the same for a rational person who's just minimizing total cost. But they're not. That's the first main finding in this paper. The second main finding is that these coefficients here for all these other financial characteristics are not zero. So why would we want them to be zero? Well, again, a sort of rational person would just pick the lowest cost. So given that we've already included total cost in our specification here, because we've got premium and out-of-pocket costs, why should I care about deductible above and beyond how much I'm already paying for the plan? I shouldn't. A rational person shouldn't. And yet people do. And yet all of these specifications, we see that people care about what the deductible is and what the donut hole is above and beyond its effect through their costs. So of course you should care what the deductible is, but only insofar as it affects how much you're paying. Once we've controlled for that, which we have because we've got these variables, you shouldn't care about it. So that's the main finding in their papers. And to summarize, they say, quote, "Our findings are striking. Elders are making choices that are inconsistent with optimization under full information. First, elders place much more weight on plan premiums than they do on expected out-of-pocket costs that they will incur under the plan. Second, consumers appear to value plan financial characteristics far beyond any impacts on their own financial expenses or risk." That's the main finding of the paper. Well, why is this important? Well, suppose that all the insurance plans that are available stays the same. And we somehow were able to get all senior citizens to make the correct choices, to pick the plans that actually had the lowest cost, and to not pay such unwarranted attention to the premiums. Well, they compute that total expenditure by these senior citizens on healthcare would go down by 27%. That is a huge number. That's why we care about these results. So, how could we actually get senior citizens to make better choices? They make a few policy proposals. One thing you could do is provide individualized information to each senior citizen. Things like sending them a letter that says, you know, last year you spent this much money on prescription drugs under Health Plan A. If you had signed up for Health Plan B, you would have spent this much money on prescription drugs. So you can actually just do the accounting for them by sending them a letter. See what happens. Another policy you can think of is requiring doctors or pharmacists to help out with these decisions for the senior citizens, instead of leaving them on their own to pick among all these over 40 health insurance plans. Now, unfortunately, figuring out exactly what the best policy is actually quite difficult, because that 27% number I just gave you depended on the assumption that the set of insurance plans stayed the same. Okay, why is that important? Well, here, what have we been doing? We've been looking at the causal effect of health plan characteristics on consumer choice. Okay, but these plans don't come from nowhere. Firms actually get together and figure out what plans to offer to consumers. And so we could think about the effect of consumer behavior, the causal effect of consumer behavior, on what the firms offer in the first place. So how do firms make decisions about what plans to offer? Well, we would need to know the answer to that causal question, in addition to this causal question, to know the full impact of a policy that changed consumer behaviors. Because not only would we be changing consumer behaviors, we might indirectly change what health insurance plans are available on the market. And that's also going to affect consumer welfare. So those are very difficult questions, but they're also very important. And that's why these papers that try to model behavior and also model how firms are reacting are very critical to trying to figure out what the best policy is.